Welcome to Evening Prayers. It's Sunday, the 19th of June. And we're going to begin with the Sabbath blessing that comes from Pete Gregg's Lectio 365. Let's pray. Lord, may this day bring Sabbath rest into my heart and into my home. May your image in me be restored and my imagination in you be restored. May the gravity of material things be lightened and the relativity of time slow down. May I know, Lord, your grace so that I may embrace my own finite smallness in the arms of your infinite greatness. May your word feed me and your spirit lead me into the week and into the life to come. Come, Lord Jesus. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Father of light and life. We ask this as we come to you today on this day of worship. Help us to focus our thoughts and minds on you. In Jesus' name. Amen. So, prodigal son from yesterday, happy ending? Yeah. But no, not quite. We have one more son to go. Let's hear that part of the story now in this picture rendering of the parable.
Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. "Your brother has come," he replied, "and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound." The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, "Look, all these years, I've been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat so I could celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him."
And here, following that, is a great meditation stroke poem about what it felt like, what it feels like maybe, to be that older son. So let's just watch this.
I don't know if you've heard the story of the prodigal son. It's the one where the son takes the money and runs. He left his father and family behind to chase a life of greater design, big money, fast living, all play, no grind. That was until the day the money ran out like sand in an hourglass. The son went from first class to outcast, couldn't predict the famine in the forecast, fell so low he started craving the food that the pigs had. So he came up with a plan. Return back to dad not as a son but as a slave hand, cause even the slaves had food that would eventually end up in the trash can. So he journeyed back home with his head hung low. There was shame in his veins, so he took his steps slow. But as he approached his family's abode, his father ran toward him with life in his bones. And before the son could even make his case to deny his bloodline and live as a slave, his father embraced him with tears in his eyes and exclaimed, "Let's throw a party because my son is alive." And that's where it ends. Everyone is happy. Father gets son gets compassion. We learn what can happen as a result of our actions. A lesson of forgiveness. It truly is a nice story. But if I'm being honest, the ending never really does it for me. See, what you might not know is that there's a third main character. You've got the father, prodigal son, and his lesser mentioned older brother. See, the older brother doesn't get a lot of attention because his side of the story doesn't turn heads or end in redemption. All he did was stay when his brother left. He wouldn't let that familial debt be the theft of his father's respect. And yet, showing him respect was the last check on his father's checklist. Because while he was busy out working in the fields, his father was busy being restless, letting the worry for his youngest choke him like an ill-fitting necklace until the pain nearly left him neckless. So the day the younger son finally returned to stay and was greeted by his father with a huge bouquet, instead of a slap to the face, you can imagine his older brother had a few words to say. like, "Father, what have I done to become the lesser loved son? I remained while he betrayed, and yet he's the one who gets a parade?" I guess personally, it's hard to empathize with the prodigal son and keep my feet under me, because honestly, I fit in his brother's shoes a lot more comfortably. I mean, let me get this straight. You go off and spoil your uninherited inheritance, lose it all because you're too blind to your own meritless arrogance, and then when you come crawling back, you're greeted with relentless preeminence. Meanwhile, I've been here for years and don't have so much as a thank you to show for it. Oh, but you want your money now? Go for it. Go blow it on women while living in worldly indulgence. Dad will just forgive you when it's over with anyway. I mean, while you were busy bouncing around towns like a ricochet, I was still at home slaving my life away because I knew my place. So where's my feast? Where's my recognition? According to the doctrine, I've been a good Christian by definition. I go to church on the weekends, read my Bible when it's convenient, say my prayers like I mean it, and in public act decent. I didn't do it because I thought it put my name up in lights, but I thought it might put me in the right light in my father's eyes. Because like I said, I knew my place. But now that place feels like last place because Dad is chasing after you like you're in first place. I feel like I shouldn't have even bothered in the first place. This is my worst case scenario. Worse yet, because now I'm supposed to be happy for you, bro? Wander through the desert just to come back to your riches? No. And my anger supposed to lessen just because you learned your lesson? I don't think so. I'm just so sick of the games, sick of the facade, sick of taking the heat like a lightning rod, sick of the neglect, sick of the fraud, and I'm sick of the time I spend trying to impress God. Now that I say it, it does sound pretty petty, because you can make a pretty penny and still be left feeling plenty empty. I mean, how do you impress the one whose breath crafted earth, the one who sculpted man out of dirt and gave birth to the universe? How can I say I was never the lost when every day I get lost in pursuit of the cross? How can I not rejoice when my brother comes back, when my crimes were equally as evil and my heart equally as black? And most importantly, I don't have to impress God because I already pressed down the nails into his son's right and left arm. Jesus disarmed the sins that I had latched on and carried on for so long so they could no longer do me harm. He pushed past my fence until he passed defenses and my sins themselves became past tense. So no, I may not be the son of prodigy, but the way that I was living makes me feel not like I ought to be. Thank God the old me's buried 6 feet underground, because he said those who were dead are now alive, and those who were lost are now found.
I remember reading a sermon once. It was in a book of sermons about what it was called, the steady son. And it was about him and kind of looked at what it felt like. Maybe in churches, and often you get the, you know, the good quiet one, the no fuss son or child in churches or in families, and they don't get any notice. They just carry on being faithfully good all the time, and then comes a moment when something happens and they suddenly say, you know, well, you know, where's my consideration? What happened about me? Why did I not get taken into account? Why did you not ask? Why did you not give me something? I've been doing this all the time. That's why we feel sorry, I think, for Martha in the Mary and Martha story. There's a lot of angst in there. Well, we're going to come tomorrow to what the Father says. I won't do that now. But for now, I just want us, with that meditation, to acknowledge that we must remember these people in our midst, the steady ones, the ones that don't go off, the ones that are the good boy or good girl. We must remember them. I remember a prophetess, coming to Open Door, and she gave various words of knowledge and insight to people, and she said one about me, and she says, Phil, God sees you just doing the ordinary things in the church. He sees you stacking the chairs. He sees you, you know, getting that bit sorted, talking with somebody in need, not noticed by anybody, but God has seen it. We need to remember that. We need to be thankful for the steady sons, but we need to remember to be thankful also when the prodigals come home. It is combined. You know, that he was ungracious to his brother because he felt unnoticed. Let's notice the quiet ones, but let's remember that we do that so we may also welcome the people coming back. I'm not going to have a song tonight because we've had quite a long meditation, but just I'm going to finish with prayer. Father God, thank you for the people in our churches and in our clubs, in our societies, in our groups, in our home groups, who just they don't make a fuss, they just get on, and sometimes it's very easy to just take for granted. Perhaps we feel like that. You know, I've just been, you know, the no fuss person, but nobody noticed me. Well, let's try and make that change in our churches. Let's try and say, I thank you, whoever you are, for being that person. But help us, Lord, not to become grudging about that, therefore, and say, well, nobody gave me a moment, so I'm not going to give them it. Let's receive generosity that we may give it out, especially to those who come back from a far country. And we make that prayer in Jesus' name, who goes in search of the lost and loves the steady sun. We just pray your blessing upon us all. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Oh, you can hear those birds out there, can you? Flipping shouldn't have put out so many fat balls. They're going mad. Anyway, with that competition in mind, I'll see you tomorrow for our final look at this parable, how it ends up in the story of the prodigal son and his brother indeed. So I'll see you tomorrow.